The Greatest Trick of All by Lee Child. I could have shot you in one ear and out the other from 1,000 yards. I could have brushed past you in a crowd, and you wouldn't have known your throat was cut until you went to nod your head and it rolled away down the street without you. I was the guy you were worrying about when you locked your doors and posted your guards and walked upstairs to bed, only to find me already up there before you, leaning on the dresser, just waiting in the dark. I was the guy who always found a way. I was the guy that couldn't be stopped. But that's over now, I guess. None of my stuff was original. I studied the best of the best long ago. I learned from all of them. A move here, a move there, all stitched together, all the tricks, including the greatest trick of all, which I learned from a man called Ryland. Back in the day, Ryland worked all over, but mainly where there was oil, or white powder, or money, or girls, or high-stakes card games. Then he got old, and he slowly withdrew. Eventually, he found the matrimonial market. Maybe he invented it, although I doubt that. But certainly he refined it. He turned it into a business. He was in the right place at the right time, getting old and slowing down just when all those California lawyers made divorce into a lottery win, just when guys all over the hemisphere started to get nervous about it. The theory was simple. A live wife goes to a lawyer, but a dead wife goes nowhere. Except the cemetery. Problem solved. A dead wife attracts a certain level of attention from the police, of course, but Ryland moved in a world where a guy would be 1,000 times happier to get a call from a cop than a divorce lawyer. Cops would have to pussyfoot around the grief issue, and there was a general assumption that when it came to IQ, cops were not the sharpest chisels in the box. Whereas lawyers were like razors. And of course, part of the appeal of a guy like Ryland was that evidence was going to be very thin on the ground. No question. A wife dead at Ryland's hands was generally considered to be a lottery win in reverse. He worked hard. Hit the microfilm and check it out. Check newspapers all over the states in Central and South America. Look at Europe, Germany, Italy. Any place where there were substantial fortunes at stake. Look at how many women went missing. Look at how old they were and how long they had been married. Then check the follow-up stories, the inside pages, the later paragraphs, and see how many hints there were about incipient marital strife. Check it out, and you'll see a pattern. The cops saw it too, of course. But Ryland was a ghost. He had survived oil and dope and money lending and hookers and gambling. No way was he going to get brought down by greedy husbands and bored wives. He flourished, and I bet his name was never written down in any cop's file. Not anywhere. Not once. He was that good. He was working back in the days when billionaires were rare. Back then, 100 million was considered a threshold level. Below 100 mil, you were poor. Above, you were respectable. People called 100 mil a unit, and most of Ryland's clients were worth 3 or 4 units. And Ryland noticed something. Rich husband, rich wife. The wives weren't rich in the sense their husbands were, of course. They didn't have units of their own. But they had spending cash. It stands to reason, Ryland said to me. Guys set them up with bank accounts and credit cards. Guys worth 3 or 4 units don't like to trouble themselves with trivia down at the six-figure level. But the six-figure level was where Ryland worked. and he noticed that the blood he was spilling was dripping all over minks and diamond chokers and Paris gowns and perforated leather seats in Mercedes Benzes. He started searching purses after a while. There were big checking balances in most of them, and platinum cards. He didn't steal anything, of course. That would have been fatal and stupid, and Ryland wasn't stupid. Not stupid at all. But he was imaginative, or so he claimed. Actually, I like to believe one of the women handed the idea to him. Maybe one a little feistier than normal. Maybe when it became clear what was about to transpire, she put in a counteroffer. That's how I like to think it all started. Maybe she said, "That rat bastard, I should pay you to off him instead." I know Ryland's ears would have pricked up at that. Anything involving payment would have gotten him interested. He would have run the calculation at the same hyperspeed he used for any calculation, from a bullet's trajectory to a risk assessment. He would have figured, this chick can afford a six-figure coat, so she can afford a six-figure hit. Thus, the greatest trick of all. Getting paid twice. He told me about it after he got sick with cancer, and I took it as a kind of anointment, the nomination of an heir, the passing of the baton. He wanted me to be the new Ryland. That was okay with me. I also took it as a mute appeal not to let him linger and suffer. That was okay with me, too. He was frail by then. He resisted the pillow like crazy, but the lights went out soon enough. And there it was. The old Ryland gone, and the new Ryland starting out with new energy.